about pain. Some essential things. We will start with physiology, consequences of pain, approaches to pain. The definition of pain. There are some definitions. As a common consensus between American-based society, International Association for Study of Pain, pain is considered an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience which is primarily associated with tissue damage or described in terms of such a damage, or both. It's easy to understand from this definition. Tissue damage related to pain. When you see something on the body, the patient can also mention easily. It's very clear. The pain arises from this damaged place. But what is more difficult to understand is what is pain described in terms of such a damage? Sometimes we cannot see in our patients the origin of pain. The all kinds of clinical examinations, paraclinical examinations, does not show us clearly where is the origin of pain actually. So, but this doesn't mean that the pain is not real and patients say that something is wrong, or we can understand that something is wrong with no apparent, clear evidence support. So pain, anyway, should be understood by the clinician. Pain should be described. Pain should be diagnosed and treated. From the point of view of experience, pain have three domains, big domains, large domains. Pain is sensory discriminative. So this means that the process of information about the strength, intensity, quality, temporal relations of pain. From another point, pain has motivational affective determinant. That means approach to the pain itself, behaviors related to the pain. From another point, pain has another dimension, cognitive evaluative. This is connected to the attitudes and the behavior of the patient from point of view of previous experience. The capacity of the patients to modulate, block, or even enhance the perception of pain. Speaking about pain, we have a few related words usually used by the people who speak about pain or write in the paper. Usually we have the connection between pain and pain threshold. Pain threshold is a point at which stimulus is perceived as pain. This pain threshold does not vary significantly among healthy people or in the same person during the time. Another word connected to pain is dominance, perceptual dominance. Intense pain in one location may cause an increase in the pain threshold in another location. Pain tolerance is expressed as duration of time or the intensity of the pain that an individual will endure before initiation some kind of response to pain. This pain tolerance is influenced greatly by a person's cultural prescriptions, expectations, behaviors, physical, mental health. Pain tolerance is generally decreased with repetitive exposure to pain. By fatigue, anger, sleep deprivation, you can see in your patients that the pain is perceived even worse when the patient is not relaxed. Patient has problems with sleeping. Tolerance to pain may be increased by alcohol consumption, medical uses, hypnosis, distracting activities, strong beliefs, faith. Connected to age, pain has different perceptual feelings. Children and elderly may be experiencing pain differently than adults. Infants in the first days of life seem to have less strong perception of pain. A full behavioral response to pain is apparent in the first 3 to 12 months of life. People between 15 or 18 years tend to have a lower pain threshold than adults. So if you have in front of you a teenager, apparently he is strong, he is tall, looks like an adult, but the pain perception is more sensitive. Pain and nociception, these are different things and you have to feel the difference. Nociception refers to the peripheral central nervous system processing information generated by stimulation of nociceptors by a noxious stimuli. Pain is a product of high brain center processing of signals it has received from pain. So nociceptions can happen in the absence of pain, actually. Pathophysiology of pain. Schematic representations you may see in front of you. So the stimulus to the right hand of this skin generate the steps, so named transduction. So this is a convey of mechanical stimuli to electric stimuli. This is the first step of pain pathophysiology. Next one is conduction. Conduction, this means transmission of this nervous already electrical signal to the next level, which happens in the spinal cord, transmission and modulation. And this step of conduction during this phase, you see a few important nerve fibers are involved. C fibers are beta, are delta fibers. We will speak separately about this. The final step is perception. Perception happens in our brains, and perception means the processing of all the signals, pain signals, in the brain, and its reflection in our mind and in our opinion, in our way we react to the pain that we perceive. So in pain processing, you have three big steps: afferent pathways, processing in the central nervous system, and efferent pathways. The afferent portion is composed of nociceptors, pain receptors, afferent nerve fibers you've seen on the skin, spinal cord network. So from nociceptors, the signals is transmitted by small alpha fibers, alpha delta, C fibers to the spinal cord. Then these nerve fibers form synapses in the dorsal horn. From dorsal horn, these signals are transmitted to higher parts of the brain through spinothalamic tracts, mostly. Small unmyelinated C neurons are responsible for the transmission of diffuse, burning, aching sensation perceptions of pain. So when the pain is perceived as a large, not clearly defined zone, transmission through the larger myelinated R-delta fibers occurs much more quickly comparing with transmission through C fibers. And these R fibers carry well-localized, sharp types of pain. Afferent pathways terminate in the dorsal horn, as I said, and these form the first afferent neuron. Second afferent neuron creates spinal part of the afferent system. And the efferent pathways composed of the fibers connected to reticular formation, midbrain, and substantia gelatinosa are responsible for modulating pain sensation. Brain firstly perceives sensation of pain and gives us understanding of what happens. Till the this place in the brain which react to the pain, until that process, pain is just electricity. Getting to the thalamus, pain is receiving its full color, which is perceived of, by our brains and expressed in our responses to pain. Cortex, thalamus, brainstem are all interconnected with hypothalamus and the autonomic nervous system. That is why the pain frequently has autonomic response. So pain, especially chronic pain, which is a drastic, unfortunate problem that happens to an individual, has frequently components like redness, swollenness in the place of the pain. So with time, you can mention change in nail growth, in hair growth on the members. So all these autonomical changes are connected to chronic pain. The afferent analgesic system, its role is to inhibit of afferent pain signals. Pain afferents stimulates neurons in the anterior aqueductal grade. From there, the impulses are transmitted through the spinal cord to the dorsal horn. By this way, they inhibit or block transmission of nociceptor signals at the level of dorsal horn. So this is a system which happens for the individuals to have as an inner mechanism to fight excessive pain. So this efferent analgesic system helps to modulate the initial pain perception and to change its value to the individual. Coming closer to the originals of pain explanation, I will mention the theory of pain. This theory was firstly elaborated by Melzig and Wolf, two scientists working in different countries, having different specialties. But in the past, in 1965, they came to the conclusion that pain is transmitted and is generated through the some of the changes that I will explain to you in a few words. According to their theory, nociceptive impulses are transmitted to the spinal cord through large R delta and small C fibers. These fibers create synapses in substanza gelatinosa. The cells in this structure, in substanza gelatinosa, act as a gate, changing transmission of impulses through the, to the central nervous system. In which way? Stimulation of large nerve fibers, R beta, causes the cells in substanza gelatinosa to close the gate. Stimulation of small fiber inhibits cells in substanza gelatinosa and open the gate. To give you an example from your practice, if by chance some of you had kind of pain perceived during a day, if suddenly you get a hit to your members to say, you may feel that the pain that you perceived before this hit is changed. It could disappear at all. So the new pain stimulated, conveyed through R alpha, R beta, or C fibers to the substanza gelatinosa, closed the gate, and you do not perceive the former pain in your body. You start to perceive maybe the new pain. So actually, this is one of the clinical examples when this theory works. Nowadays, we cannot say this theory is absolutely getting responses to all kind of knowledge that we gain in time about pain and flow. But it explains mainly a lot of things connected to the so-called normal pain. So, getting further, speaking about nociceptor itself. You see on the scheme a lot of factors can generate chemicals that are actually keeping or generating pains. You see histamine, progesterone, bradykinins, interleukins, tumor necrosis factors, ATP, adenosine. So all these chemicals generate or keep alive the pain in our bodies. This chemical from different cells, mast cells, macrophage, platelets, then immune cells. All of them are able to maintain the pain perception and get the pain even worse. From the point of view of chemicals, receptors involved in pain, you have the schematic representation of the synaptic transmission. You may notice in this scheme a few big portions responsible and connected to the pain perception and transmission. You see here opioids, calcium voltage channels, calcium natrium voltage channels as well. You see other receptors, AMPA, NMDA, non-methyl aspartate. from anesthesiology course, maybe you remember, you call non-aspartates chemicals used largely as anesthetic medication, ketamine. Ketamine partly acts through non-methylaspartate receptors. They tend to have a big place in pain therapy now. A lot of traumatic pains are connected to these non-methylaspartates, and the ketamine acts on them. So you see, if you have in your possession as actors, chemicals to fight the pain, usually the pain reacts through these type of ways. You see, opioid receptors, calcium, calcium, natrium channels, you see GABA receptors as well here, and NMDA, non-methylaspartates, and so on. So, knowing a lot about pain, actually, we have to act in our patients through medications, but these medications are situated around this actually type of action through pain channels, opioid receptors, GABA, serotonin receptors, NMDA, and non-methylaspartate, mostly. Opioids, some of them are natural, morphine, codeine, some semi-synthetic, heroin, codeine, and a lot of them are synthetic opioids, betadine, fentanyl, methadone, dexmedetomidine, tramadol. It's important to know that each time we act through opioid receptors, we generate a few well-known effects. If you act through new receptors, you see here on the table new, one and two, kappa and delta receptors. These are not the full range of receptors, opioid receptors involved in pain action. There are a little more receptors. From clinical point, I mentioned a few just here. If you act through opioid receptors, you see a few important effects. You have analgesia, sedation, you may have respiration, physical benefits. So if you put your patients on opioids, all these effects are easily to be generated. You see, mu one receptors are mostly analgesic, mu two provoke respiratory depression, kappa mostly analgesia, sedation, mostly. Delta receptors provoke spinal and spinal mostly and supraspinal analgesia. Less. So, if you go through this table from health, you can say that if we develop selective medication that acts on these receptors, like mu1, V or kappa or delta, we may be very satisfied because we don't have another type of reactions of your receptors, as I mentioned here, new general, new sedation, spiritual depression, visual dependence. Apparently, this is right, but from clinical point, developing now the medication which are very selective, provoking just analgesia with no side effects. Unfortunately, it's not clinically valuable. if you act through selective receptors, you will not get the medication which will be able to be used in large quantities on the pain threshold. So we act in our clinics mostly for strong pains through new receptors that are larger affecting and provoking euphoria, sedation, spiritual depression, physical dependence, besides analgesia, for what we actually indicate this communication for our patients. So all these effects will happen when you use, to say, morphine in patients. A few particular features of the opioids, weak opioids, you can see here, sensitivity of different opioids used in blood-brain clinic to different receptors. Codeine and tramadol are weak opioids. Their affinity to the mu kappa receptors is low. Strong opioids, morphine, oxycodone, you see below, have a very good, very strong affinity to the mu kappa receptors. So when you put your patients on tramadol or codeine, you know that this medication is not strongly affecting, actually not giving full enough pain control. Morphine, oxycodone have very strong affinity to receptors and they will provoke a very good pain reaction, a pain control reaction. Instead of this, tramadol has additional mechanism, which is important in tramadol. Tramadol acts largely affecting the serotonin and noradrenaline reuptake. So mostly the effect on pain control of tramadol is connected to this serotonin and noradrenaline reuptake inhibition. This tramadol is not a full agonist, and not a very good medication as a mark for opioid, pure opioid action. Neuropathic pain is something that you have to use, to be used to treat in your practice, because neuropathic pain is a difficult pain to be treated. Neuropathic pain is different from nociceptive normal pain. It's the result of the abnormal processing of nerve impulses in the central nervous system. A few words about one of the effects of the pain treatment. Opioid-induced hyperalgesia. This is a condition which overlaps with opioid tolerance, and the difference between opioid-induced hyperalgesia and opioid tolerance is that opioid tolerance is an increased amount of opioids that is given to a patient to relieve the pain, but unfortunately, this increased amount of opioids which you give to the patient can provoke this opioid-induced hyperalgesia, which is the addition of the opioids to the patient in pain actually brings up the pain, so the pain becoming worse. So you may find this term in the clinical practice. When you have a patient and the patient complain of the pain which becomes worse, you increase the dosing, but suddenly patient says dosing that the pain became even worse. So you have to be clear in this situation what happens to the patient? Maybe it's an increase in the pain itself, and it happens frequently in cancer patients, or it's an opioid-induced hyperalgesia, which is treated differently. If you have a decrease in pain tolerance in patients, you bring up the dosing and you succeed to control the pain, in opioid-induced hyperalgesia, you will not bring up the dosing. You have to change, maybe to change the opioid, maybe to reduce the opioid use and combine the opioids that you are increasing with another opioid. Or even you can add some medication that through different mechanisms on the same way. So be careful, opioid-induced hyperalgesia. You have to be able to differentiate from case tolerance. When you don't treat and don't control well the pain in your patients, you may have different clinical features apart from strong pain perceived. One of them is effects on cardiovascular system and pulmonary system. In a patient in pain, you have increased heart rate, increased by blood pressure, increased peripheral vascular resistance, altered regional blood flow, the increased consumption of oxygen by heart. You have reduced telephasis, increased cough reflexes, hypoxemia. Chances to get infected also are increasing. So from point of view of the clinical activity, if you do not control well the pain in your patients, you have a delay in rehabilitation and function. You have chances to develop a chronic pain in your patients with long-term disability. You have increased hospitalization period. You have increased cost of treatment. You have decreased patient satisfaction. Inadequate pain management also causes to doubt the effectiveness of the physician and medical system. Ongoing pain may result in decreased pain threshold, which could lead to patients' overuse or misuse of analgesics. Physicians often underprescribe for pain, unfortunately, waiting for responses. And if you don't come back with effective methods, you have a lot of stigma related to pain as well. One of the consequences of bad pain control is self-addiction as well. Thank you. The second presentation dedicated also to pain is mostly a clinical one. Important to doesn't matter where you practice, actually. We will speak about general things and common for all. You can see some of the expressions which underline the importance of pain in the humans. The Albert Schweitzer was a famous German philosopher, thinker, doctor, you can imagine from his practice, he had quite strong impressions on pain. Just to mention the way we are with our discussion about pain in palliative care. So if you see here in this table, chronic pain condition affect, say, 100 million Americans early. Diabetes, 25 million Americans. Coronary heart disease, 16. Stroke, 7 million Americans. Cancer, 11 million Americans. So speaking about chronic pain, cancer, you see the how hugely this kind of medical states with which is connected to very strong, unpleasant, different pain affect millions of people in America. Why I put a table with data from America? Because they are more accurate and show this in different kind of studies. Unfortunately, this information is not so easy to be find in the other countries. From point of view of statistics, around 2/3 of patients with metastatic or terminal cancer have pain. Majority of these people has middle severe pain. Around 60% of patients on anti-cancer treatment also have pain. And 1/3 of patients after curative treatment feels pain. Important to know that they are not each type of disease, each stage of disease is immediately connected to pain in the patients. So be careful. Don't mix diagnosis of cancer or another severe illness with presence of pain. That is why it's important to understand sensible part of these questions. When the pain is in place, you have the full options to imply. If the pain is absent, but the disease like cancer is present, you don't have to put patients on pain treatment. From point of view of clinics, as a basic approach, you have to be able to distinguish a few classifications related to a diagnosis of pain. So from point of view of physiopathology, pain could be nociceptive. It has somatic effectiveness. It has visceral components. From point of view of physiopathology, there is another type of pain, which is neuropathic, which could be central, peripheric. So what is neuropathic pain? And we started to speak about this in the former presentation. Neuropathic pain is pain initiated or caused by primarily lesion or disease of the somatosensory nervous system. Which part of the said somatosensory nervous system is affected? All of them could be. Somatic and autonomous as well. Another classification is pain intensity. When we measure pain using one of or another scale, we have to put the notes. So it helps in the clinic very much, actually. If you practice this, it is not a big deal. Pain classification from point of view of intensity here is mild, moderate, or severe. Mild, when the pain says that his pain between 0 and 10 is less than 4. When pain reported pain, which is between 4 and 6, on this scale, pain is considered moderate. When the patient complains of pain which is more than 7 in the scale, we categorize the pain as being severe. From a point of view of temporal relation, pain could be acute, pain that is less than 3 months as duration is considered acute. I speak in general. Cancer pain is distinguished. Acute pain in a cancer patient is considered less than 2 weeks, but it's a separate part. Chronic pain is a pain which is lasting more than 3 to 6 months, but mostly 3 months is enough to be more accurate. Another definition of chronic pain is a pain persisting beyond the course of an acute disease or after tissue healing is complete. Incidental pain, it's another type of temporal related pain, is and breakthrough pain. Both of these pains happens largely in patients with chronic diseases in palliation. Incidental pain and breakthrough pain, we will speak separately about this, needs your special consideration as clinicians. A few words about acute pain. It happens in your patients with cancer or other diseases. Acute pain actually serves as a protective mechanism that alerts the individual that something is not well. Onset in acute pain is usually sudden, and responses that are generated by the body for acute pain are usually increased heart rate, increased respiratory rate, elevated blood pressure, pallor, flushing, dilated pupils, perspiration, high blood sugar, increased blood sugar, and decreased gastric acid secretion, decreased gastric motility, and blood flow to the viscera, kidney, skin. Occasionally, you may mention nausea in the patient with pain. So, all kinds of these effects you see actually affect very much the body. So, this happens besides sensation of pain in an individual. Chronic pain, as you know, the pain which lasts longer than 3 months, in non-cancer pain, is persistent or intermittent, usually defined as a pain with a hallmark of changes. In the chronic pain, the cause of the pain is often unknown, often develops insidiously, very often is associated with a sense of hopelessness and helplessness, associated with depression. Physiological response to chronic pain is, in case of intermittent pain, a physiological response is similar to acute pain. In cases when the pain is persistent, it allows different kind of adaptation for the individuals. Chronic pain produces significant behavioral, psychological changes to the patient. The main changes are depression, association of chronic pain with depression is very frequent, an attempt to keep the pain-related behavior to a minimum, so the patient will react with not comparable with acute pain reflections, like being calm, being retracted, not showing his problems and pains, not showing his suffering. Sleeping disorders, preoccupation with the pain, tendency to deny pain even. So see the difference between acute pain and chronic pain. A chronic pain patient is distinct from acute one. Chronic pain, as you see and you've seen in the table, affecting a lot of sufferers, and it provokes a lot of costs for the health system. Breakthrough pain is a pain, so it's an increase in pain of short duration in patients with stable and acceptable analgesia provided by analgesic even around the clock. So, breakthrough pain arises in a patient who is getting some kind of medication for pain, which is good. I mean, that's a good controlled pain. But nevertheless, even the majority of the day, the pain is well controlled. Patient has some kind of acute rise in the pain. This is so named breakthrough cancer pain. Treatment of breakthrough cancer pain is usually 1/6 of the daily opioid dose. So this is important very much. You have a patient in pain, you offer a treatment scheme, but immediately in the same period of time, you offer something for breakthrough cancer pain, which is actually mainly 1/6 of the opioid daily dose. As I mentioned, pain initiated, of course, by primary relation to or dysfunction of the somatosensory nervous system is neuropathic. It could happen when the peripheral nerve damage occurs, it will be a peripheral nerve, neuropathic pain. When the damage to the central nervous system happens, we call it central neuropathic pain. The most frequent source of neuropathic pain is the peripheral nervous system. Neuropathic pain could be intermittent or constant, spontaneous or provoked. And typical description that you see in your patients is pain described with words like shooting, stabbing, electric shock-like, burning, tingling, tight, numb, prickling, itching, sensation of pins and needles, etc. So you imagine the patient who is coming to you, and you, when you ask the patient to describe his pains with words, he is using this type of description. It's not common for a normal pain. So when the patient says words like this, look for neuropathic problems, neuropathic types of pain in this patient. Often you see and you mention allodynia in hyperalgesia. For neuropathic pain, we see heterogeneity of etiology, many symptoms and medical conditions associated. As examples, peripheral diabetic neuropathy, postherpetic neuralgia, trigeminal neuralgia, radicular pain, pain after surgery, post-chemotherapy, post-radiotherapy pain, central pain after spinal cord injury. All these medical conditions are associated with chronic pain. Usually when you use words or read articles about pain, neuropathic pain especially, chronic pain, you'll see definitions or expressions like hyperalgesia connected to pain. So what is hyperalgesia? Increased pain from a stimulus that normally provokes pain. Hyperesthesia, paresthesia, which is an abnormal sensation, whether spontaneous or evoked. Anesthesia, loss of sensation resulting from pharmacological depression of nerve function. Neuralgia, pain in the distribution of a nerve or nerves. Allodynia, pain due to that does not normally provoke pain. Neuropathy, the disturbance of function or pathological change in a nerve, in one nerve, mononeuropathy, in several nerves, motoneuropathy, multiplex, polyneuropathy. As I mentioned, cancer pain is separate from chronic pain. So a patient with cancer in pain, you don't wait for three months to consider this pain as being chronic. In a cancer pain lasting more than 2 weeks is already treated and considered chronic. Most importantly, it should be treated accordingly. Pain in cancer could be as a consequence of the cancer growth. It could be caused by specific treatments for cancer. You frequently mention in chemotherapy, vasospasm, phlebitis, peripheral neuropathy, infections, rash after radiotherapies, radiculomyelitis, mucositis. Pain and cancer could be generated by surgical treatment, never known post-thoracotomy syndrome, phantom pain. Pain and cancer also could be not caused by cancer. Diabetic neuropathy, neuralgia, headache, angina. Why it's important to know this? Patient with cancer does not necessarily have just only pains connected to cancer itself. Patient can have different kind of pathologies associated to cancer, which also have chronic or acute pain conditions. It's important to distinguish each time you have a patient, which type of pain the patient's got, because the treatment is different. One of the conceptions which underlined the pains in palliative care is total pain. Total pain is a concept that comprises all of the painful components that the patient will suffer during slow progression from diagnosis to death. Pain has psychological, social, emotional, spiritual components that make up the total pain experience. And each problem contributes to the total pain perception. The caregiver should be aware of these various components in order to try to appropriately respond to patient in need, covering all kinds of problems that brings negatives to this pain patient. It is clear that such massive total suffering cannot be endured by one single person. That is why in palliative care we work in a company, in a model which involves different kinds of specialists. For those of you who can maybe more easy remember this kind of exposure of the text, like skins, you see total pain concept expressed by this draw. You see psychological, spiritual, social aspects of suffering, total pain, besides physical ones about which we speak so much. Don't forget the patient in pain and suffering have anger, loss of faith, finding meaning in their lives, fear of unknown. They have problems from social aspects, loss of the role in the family, loss of the job, financial concerns, worries about future, dependency, depression, other illnesses with very unpleasant past, anxiety and so on, besides this physical problem, as pain itself. I mentioned that from aspect of the pain intensity, we have to appreciate each patient in pain, the intensity of this feeling, for which we have usually this type of tools. I will point your attention on numerical rating score. This is second line here. This is a score that is mostly used in practice. It's very easy to apply and easy to explain to the patient. So you see a line between 0 and 10, divided from 0 and 10 in points, and you propose this line for your patient to imagine that we measure the pain, comparing the pain perception with line of numbers from 0 to 10. zero in this line is no pain. 10, it's the worst pain the patient can imagine. Very important to explain this type of medicine to the patient, because if you don't give the same explanations as we speak now, can have different results. So what's important to underline? Zero is no pain, and 10, the worst pain the patient could imagine. This numerical rating score, you see, you have to register in your medical record. Another way to measure the pain is visual analog scale. Also the same instruction, 0 and 10. But visual analog scale actually represents a line between 0 and 10. So the patient had to mark between 0 and 10 where the pain is perceived like on this line. Another way to measure the pain is verbal descriptive scale. The same, you can ask the patient the pain between 0 and 9, and you see if the patient says the pain is 3, you consider it middle, 4 to 6 moderate, severe 7 and 9, and support of death. Not so frequently used in practice, 0 to 9 looks to be very good and easy to apply. Very important in your practice. So each time you have a patient, if you don't measure the pain, you'll still have doubts what to choose as a medication and how the pain treatment progresses. The evaluation of pain in children, you see a Wong Baker face scale. You can compare the express of the face of the child and to put marks by yourself. Also, you can ask the patient, the child, to appreciate his pain or her pain by itself. With little explanations and patient, you can get this result from the patient, small children. Here you can see the pain letter, which was developed in the 80s, last century. You see here three steps of the letter. One is first one, for which we offer non-opioid analgesic, plus minus adjuvants. When the pain is stronger, you remember, from 4 to 6, you have the second step of the ladder, for which you offer weak opioids, plus minus non-opioids, plus minus adjuvants, and the strong pain, which is in patients that report pain more than 7, for this group of patients, you have strong opioids. Plus minus adjuvants or plus minus non-opioids. Schematically, you can see it's represented like this. It's more easy maybe to understand and to represent. So for each patient, for each pain, you apply the same sequencing of appreciation. If the pain is on numerical rating scale, to say, less than 4, you choose mainly non-opioid. Second step, pain on numerical rating, say for 4 to 6, the main choose will be a weak opioid, and for strong pains like 7 more on numerical rating scale, you are welcome to use strong opioid. You see each step of the analgesic ladder, you can use, you can co-use with opioids, non-steroidal analgesics plus minus co-analgesics. We will speak about this later, what means analgesics. For each step of analgesic ladder, don't forget about some particular things. You see, step one of analgesic. Here I expose the most used one. You see the maximum dosing for each analgesic, which is in this table. So if you have a patient with weak pain, mild pain, you can use this analgesic, but don't forget about the maximum daily dosing. For second step analgesic ladder, you have weak opioids, codeine, dextroamphetamine, tramadol, hydrocodone, pentazocine, fortral. Mostly these are for this type of pain. Again, you see the maximum daily dosing. Tramadol 400 mg per day. Sometimes in palliative care we use by 600 mg per day. Codeine, dihydrocodeine 240-360 mg per day. Again, don't exceed this maximum dosage. Why? If you use more than this maximum dosing, usually you have not so much gain in pain control, but you'll see a lot of increasing in adverse effects. That is why we have these limits for the second step ladder. The third step, the main medication, which is a medication of so-named gold standard, is morphine. Then we have oxycodone, fentanyl, buprenorphine, methadone, hydromorphone, pethidine, promedol. A special consideration about promedol in these lines, unfortunately, promedol is not so good for a patient with long, strong pain. Promedol, unfortunately, has limits in its use. It has maximum dosing, it is short acting, and promedol products of metabolism, unfortunately, does not bring well-being to the patient. They are very acting, unfortunately, neurotoxic. That is why promedol is not good in this list. You can see in this line of medications, everything except the maximum dosing. So compare with previous tables. The use of strong opioids is actually connected not to maximum dosing, but to the most tolerable dosing. So we increase the quantity of strong opioids according to the pain we have. We increase the dosing till the point at which the pain is controlled. And we use this dosing until the pain changes. If the pain becomes worse, we increase the dosing of morphine. We stop with using opioids and we consider that it's not more possible to increase the dosing when the pain does not tolerate the adverse effect. That is why the pain medication for strong pains don't have the maximum analgesic dosing. Co-analgesics, you've seen them, they are good to be used together with strong opioids, which are the mainstay of treatment of pains in palliative care. These co-analgesics are co-used with opioids because they bring additional pain control. These co-analgesics belong to a large group of medications like antidepressive drugs. Largely, we use amitriptyline, nortriptyline, desipramine, clonazepam for our patients. We use also anti-epileptics like carbamazepine, pregabalin, gabapentin mostly as co-analgesics. Also, we co-use in special types of pain in cancer patients, steroids. Also, non-methyl aspartate antagonists like ketamine, alpha-adrenergic antagonists, clonidine, as example, neuroleptics, bufenidine, haloperidol, local anesthetics, antihistamines, bisphosphonates for bone pains. So these co-analgesics bring additional help in cancer patients with neuropathic mainly pains. Other treatment methods in palliative care also in pain control. Neurosurgery, mesotomia, radiculotomia, commissurotomia used to stop the pain. Interventional techniques like individual blocks of sympathetic select peripheric nerves. Neurolysis also used. Final administration of opioids. Spinal cord stimulation techniques. Psychosocial therapy. WHO has a list of principles of pain treatment. This list belongs not only to pain and palliative care, but to all types of pain, chronic especially. It's important to remember, multidimensional assessment of pain severity is essential. So look at your patients from a large point, not only put accent on the physical perception of pain. Start treatment with the right medicine according to the pain scale, based on the outcome of the examination. Analgesia is recommended on a regular basis according to the pharmacokinetics and formulation of the medication. Medication for breakthrough pain should be prescribed. Laxative, unnecessary, and should be prescribed for most patients receiving opioid analgesics, because one of the side effects of opioids is constipation. And it happens universally. Co-analgesic or adjuvants must be considered and selected according to the pain type. So if you see in your patient neuropathic components of the pain, you use co-analgesic, the same as adjuvants. So it's the word, two words describing the same thing. Paracetamol, non-steroidal analgesic should be used in all steps of the analgesic ladder unless contraindicated. You've seen this when I spoke about the pain ladder. Oral administration of drugs is mostly recommended in chronic cancer pain. Despite the attitudes in different countries, in many countries, unfortunately, where the accent is put on injections for pain. Same was traditional model for many years, unfortunately. The strong opioid of choice is morphine. So morphine is a drug for each. All other types of medicals for pain are measured. In palliative care, we speak usually about a few general concepts. How to treat this pain. Each pain implies a full and correct evaluation, defining the etiology and specific treatment. Analgesia in pain in palliative care should be simple, thus should be revised frequently, and be attentive to side effects. Opioid treatment should be continuous in palliative care. In chronic pains at regular intervals, so by the clock, plus supplementation for breakthrough pain. So if you have a patient with cancer, don't forget that pain treatment should be regular, by the clock, not by the pain. Your medical indication should be prescribed by ours. Plus supplementation for breakthrough pain. So one line, you'll give the medication for the pain. Second line of prescription will be medication for breakthrough pain. Concept of analgesia in palliative care does not end with this just one. As I mentioned, there is no maximum dose for stronger pain. Second step two has maximum dosing, third step does not have it. Oral, rectal routes of medication are preferred. When impossible, transdermal or subcutaneous ways are used. It could be done intermittently or continuously by 3 trials. Correct use of analgesics and nerve blocks. Addiction and tolerance is not a problem with patients with advanced cancer. Choose the right medication according to WHO pain level. General principle of opioid-using cancer pain. I will repeat it. Oral use is preferable. By the clock, according to WHO level. Individually dosing, treatment of adverse effects, attention to detail. In chronic pain associated with cancer, we apply a few main types of approaches. Treatment of underlying disease, it brings help to cancer pain. So chemo therapy, radiotherapy, surgery, removing of pain of tumors, of metastasis, brings relaxation, relieving of pain. Another way, analgesics. For analgesics, you know about this already. Anesthetic procedures, neurolysis, neurosurgery helps. Physical therapy, lifestyle changes, treatment of other aspects of suffering, which can cause or aggravate the pain, are also applicable. Don't forget this physical therapy, lifestyle changes, actually has to come as a bench of help to cancer patients. The purpose of pain management in cancer is to promptly recognize and assist the patient with cancer pain. Do not postpone your action. Recognize psychological, spiritual influences on perception and pain management. If you cannot recover from the first instant the full pain through the day in the patient, put accents on pain relief at night, firstly, at rest and in motion. Keep the maximum possible quality of life and patient independent. Your medical recommendations should bring a better quality to the patient. Reduce current and future fears about pain. Patient has a lot of unpleasant thinkings about pain and the suffering they are going through. Reduce it. Provide support and encouragement for carers of patients with pain. Pain should be not only pain treatment not should be only initiated by continuously supported, and it should be done regularly. So if you are a family physician, you have to keep in your mind that the patient in front of you should be asked as frequently as possible about the pain and suffering and medication. So patient pain and treatment effectiveness assessment must be continued. When you should come with questions about pain perception, after initiation of treatment, what it means. If you today prescribe the medication, ask the next day about patient perception of pain, intensity, color of pain, duration of action of your medication, and side effects at least. These are three main domains you have to approach. The second day you started the treatment. When you have to approach again your patient pain, at each new report about another pain. So if the patient comes and says, look, I'm getting some medication for my pain, but now I have another pain sensation in another area. So you have to restart again to appreciate and diagnose the next pain appearance. Also, recheck the patient's pain at appropriate intervals after each drug or non-pharmacological intervention. If you applied in your clinical setting a parenteral administration of opioids, it's enough to ask the pain perception after 15 or 30 minutes of the subcutaneous or intramuscular injection or intravenous injection of an opioid. It's already enough to make a conclusion. Oral morphine initiation. Be careful, because this is a topic which is important to be applied to each patient in your practice. So initiation of oral morphine should be done. If you speak about ordinary patients, you may start with 10 milligrams per os each 4 hours regularly. It means if the patient is normal with no other comorbidities, with no problems as some type of cardiac insufficiency, renal insufficiency, hepatic insufficiency, patient which is not elderly, is not weak, it's not at the end of life, it's conscious, it's not unconscious. In these patients, we consider normal dosing, which is 10 milligrams per os each 4 hours. It will be 16 milligrams of oral morphine in the first day. In case of elderly patients, weak patients, patients with acute renal insufficiency or chronic renal insufficiency, 5 milligrams per os each 4 to 6 hours, again, regularly. Additional to this, for breakthrough pain treatment, it will be another dose, supplementary to the dose that you already see here, equal to 4 hours dose. In our first case, in an ordinary patient, which receives the starting 10 milligrams per os each 4 hours, 60 milligrams per day, you give for breaks of pain 10 milligrams dose. So if the patient reports the pain arising 1, 2, 3, 4 times a day, you can recommend, look, your basic dosing will be 60 milligrams total per day. But when you have these additional pains, you may take additional 10 milligrams for these pains. Patients previously on parenteral morphine, and in case you want to convey these patients to enteral morphine, what you do? Multiply the total daily morphine dose, which is given intramuscularly, subcutaneous, or intravenously, by 2, please. And divide by 6 to find the 4 hours dose. So what do you do? In our case, when you start the patient, to say taking 10 milligram intramuscular or intravenous or subcutaneous each 4 hours of morphine, it will be 60 milligram per day parenterally as injection. Total daily dosing will be 120 milligram per day of oral dosing or 20 milligram per oral each 4 hours. So this is a scheme how to convert the patient which is receiving parenteral morphine to enteral morphine. So we multiply the parenteral quantity per day by 2 to get the oral dosing of morphine. Initiation of subcutaneous or intramuscular morphine or intravenous morphine, the same, in an opioid naive patient. In case of patients that cannot swallow, in these cases, we use subcutaneous forms. Patients who cannot swallow, patients which are incautious, patients which has problems with understanding memories and other psychiatric diseases. In these cases, we choose parenteral morphine for pain treatment. So in an ordinary patient, we will start with 5 milligrams every 4 hours, even to 6 hours. So if you remember, you recall when we discussed the dosing for ordinary patients by mouse of morphine, it was 60 milligrams of morphine per day, speaking about same patients, but with subcutaneous stuff, we will use 30 milligrams of morphine per day. For patients which are terminal, we even half this dosing. So we'll give 5 milligrams every 8 to 12 hours, testly. These are dosing for initial treatment. In another ways, in other words, morphine dosage equivalence is oral to intramuscular subcutaneous dose is like 2 to 1, or 10 milligram of oral morphine is equivalent with 5 milligram of intramuscular or subcutaneous morphine. Same about important to know that speaking about opioids, we take into consideration the equianalgesic balancing between them. So 10 milligram of oral morphine is approximately equivalent with 5 milligram of subcutaneous intravenous morphine, 100 milligram of oral codeine, 2 milligram of oral hydromorphone, and 5 to 7 milligram of oral oxycodone. To be more flexible and more easy to understand what to choose and how to play with this dosing, you may find in internet a lot of equivalent analgesics tables and conversions. Now you know already how to start morphine from previous examples, and if in the first doses, in the first day even, you come to examine the next day the patient's pain, and you mention that the first day actually did not resolve the patient's pain, and the patient reports a lot of pains, so you have to reconsider the dose. If the first doses produce low analgesia, you can increase the next day the dosing by 15%, 25 to 50%. If the pain reported the next day after your initiation of morphine is still strong and the patient reports the pain which is from 7 to 10 in the American rating scale, So you increase, you may increase the dosing by 50 to 100. If the first doses of opioid medication produce intense sedation, you have to reduce the dosing by 50%. Breakthrough dosing, you don't forget. Each time you reassess your patients in pain, you ask about how many breakthrough doses the patient needed in the previous day. If this breakthrough doses was repeated 1 to 4 to 5 times a day, you can stay in the same treatment regime. If the patient reports frequent needs in breakthrough dosing, in this case, you have to reconsider the general dosing and to calculate how much breakthrough doses the patient needed in the previous days to summarize and to increase the general dosing. A few words about side effects. Opioids bring a lot of side effects, and some of them are stable during the whole treatment period. Some of them are temporary. Constipation will stay in a patient with pain treatment for a long time, probably for the life of the time. Nausea, vomiting is a medical situation which happens during the initiation period or during the increase in the dose. So recommend your patients to take some anti-nausea, anti-vomiting medication each time you prescribe and use medication at the first instant or increase the dose. So at first instant, when you prescribe an opioid, don't forget about the prescription of anti-nausea and vomiting medication at least for 1 or 2 weeks, because in 1 or 2 weeks the nausea and vomiting will decrease and the patient will not feel anymore nausea and vomiting from this medication for pain. Another unfortunate side effects of opioids at the start is sedation as well, which also, as nausea and vomiting, is a short living, 1 or 2 weeks, and it resides, it becomes less and less. Another opioid effect, side effects, is urinary retention. It happens, patients can even ask for help. Itch and rash, unfortunately, not easy. If you increase the dosing of opioids for your patients may complain itch, rash. Frequent side effects, opioid side effects, is dry mouth. Respiratory depression, it's a rare side effect, and you'll not see a frequent respiratory depression in your practice if you are following the recommendation I was giving you today, and you'll follow tightly the protocols for pain treatment in your country. But don't forget about drug interactions. Morphine and cholinergics, they have the different interaction with medication the patient is taking. Culture affects pain experience. Our nations frequently have stoicism versus expressivity. I mean, stoicism, it's a sign of nations' adaptation probably to these critical states, and our patients report pain usually less than it is in real, which unfortunately has clinical implication. If you are not asking the patient about his pain, you face frequently a poor report of the pain. So be insistent, be insidious. Ask your patients about the pain he's suffering, don't wait the patient to report just the pain. In country like many countries with strong regimes in the past, this just brings, unfortunately, bad things to the pain perception. You also have to take into consideration that this describing of the pain, men describe pain not so colored, with poor words, so help them. When you ask the patient to describe his pain in order to appreciate if it's neuropathic or normal one, give words as examples, the patient can recall maybe better the pain sensation they have. Decisions about managing pain. In many countries, the decision to take an opioid present a kind of a problem that they perceive as a problem of culture. Many countries does not like the prescription of morphine for pain. Why? Frequently they mention that probably if the pain should be treated with morphine, it means the death is close. Or patient may say, I don't want morphine because probably if the pain will become worse, if morphine I agreed to took too early, I will have problems in the future. Nothing will help my pain anymore because morphine, in my conception, is the last medication for pain. So there are a lot of misconceptions of the pain in the cultural families. So be attentive to this detail. Some words about tolerance. Tolerance is reduced potency of analgesics, effects of opioids, following repeated administration. So increasing doses are necessary to produce the pain relief. This is tolerance. Tolerance is related to opioid receptor regulation. It is less common in patients with cancer pain. And often reasons patient does not use the normal needed quantity of opioids at the terminal phase, tolerance. So be careful when you have the patient, you have to ask the patient opinion about pain treatments, about the medication you're going to use, and to explain to the patient what is tolerance. In our clinics, we frequently discuss with patients and they bring up the questions like, would I have become less sensible to the pain medication if I'll use this opioid? In part, yes, but tolerance will develop very rarely and very late in cancer patients. So give your patients normal directives. Tolerance and addiction are different things. Many patients are afraid to accept morphine for pain treatment because they are afraid of addiction. Explain for your patients, but first of all, explain for yourself. What is addiction? Addiction is a psychological dependence in the past terms, but it is a pattern of drug use characterized by a craving for opioids, manifested by compulsive drug-seeking behavior, leading to overwhelming involvement in use and procurement of these drugs. So this is a psychiatric disease, addiction. We don't have addiction in our patients normally. It happens very rarely. If you are respecting the protocols, you are giving the right dosing of medication for the right patient, you'll never see addiction in your patient. So be careful, explain very well, and give detailed explanation to the patient about addiction, its role, and what is tolerance. because this question, these two terms are misunderstood by our patients. So for pharmacologic treatment of cancer pain, you have to select appropriate analgesic according to WHO level, prescribe the appropriate dose for medication, prescribe through the most appropriate route of medication use, you remember, plan appropriate interval between doses, prevent persistent pain, early breakthrough pain, aggressively titrate drug use, prevent, anticipate, and treat side effects, take into account the successive use of analgesics, use appropriate analgesics. The principles of the patient-centered care. A lot of treatments in our medicine is centered on the patient. For this, in concerning pain problems, treat the patient as a unique person. Explore the patient's experience of illness and pain. Perceive pain management from the patient's perspective. Put yourself in patient's shoes. Promote shared decision making and adapt care to meet the patient's needs and expectations. I was telling about some myths that stays in patients' minds about opioids. Unfortunately, these myths are common in doctors as well. One of the myths says people who take morphine always need more and more medication. What you should explain for your patients in this case? The truth is like this. The opioids may appear to have stopped working when in reality an increase in dose is needed. The most common reason is that the disease is progressing and there is a change in the level of pain experienced by the patient. Another reason is tolerance, which means that increasing dose medication is needed to achieve comfort for the patient. Tolerance does not develop suddenly. If the person no longer gets pain relief at one dose level, it can be increased. Another myth, people who need medication like morphine for pain control are always very ill and need it. It's not correct. The truth is, like this, just because the person needs an opioid medication such as morphine to control pain does not mean that they are gravely ill or near death. Opioids are very effective medications that can be used at any stage of the disease trajectory. And if the pain becomes less, you can easily reduce the pain medication gradually. Another myth, opioids are only given in the final stages of a person's illness. No, and that's because pain is a common symptom for people who are living with a terminal or progressive illness, whether they are in their last months, weeks, or days of life. As opioids are strong and effective painkillers, they can be used at any point of a person's terminal illness. When it's difficult to manage their pain, it's another type of medication. So be careful, give needed recommendations to your patients. Express, try to find out the expressed fears of the pain treatment with our medication. Be proactive with your patients. Conclusions. Cancer pain is undertreated in many cases, unfortunately. Even if theoretically the available therapeutic means and the irrational use according to WHO principles, would allow excellent results of pain treatment in more than 95% of patients. The vast majority of cancer pain can be well controlled by the judicious use of available non-opioid and opioid medication, co-analgesics, non-pharmacological and non-invasive methods. WHO scale recommend pain treatment in 3 steps depending on the pain intensity. Cancer pain is a result of a compressive or invasive action of the tumor on soft tissues, bones, organs, faces, nerves, but may happen as a consequence of the use diagnostic or therapeutic procedure. Pain approach from the patient's perspective is crucial. Thank you.